So let's talk about outfits. No matter where you are or what you do, if you want to fit in, you'll probably dress the part. An FBI agent working to tirelessly expose Soviet spies might put on a suit and flash their badge, while an undercover Russian operative trying to blend in will probably ditch their furry Ushanka hat and slip into something a bit more American. And just like people, words will often wrap themselves up in whatever garb matches the grammatical role they're supposed to play. So, where do they get these get-ups, and what do they do when they can't find anything that fits? I'm O.T. Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
Verbs are kind of like the engines that drive sentences, and they usually come with a set of pretty specific instructions. The act of poisoning, for instance, comes with two clearly defined roles that have to be filled. A poisoner and someone who gets poisoned, as in, Elizabeth poisoned the college student. Something like give has three, a giver, a recipient, and whatever's being exchanged, like in, William gave the container to Philip. These words can't function unless they're supplied with the necessary pieces to complete the picture. Zooming out a little, we can find patterns across different verbs. Both poison and give, along with countless other verbs, need agents, phrases that represent the doer of the action. And verbs often also need themes, which are the people and things that a verb affects. Of course, verbs can have other requirements too, like experiencers of emotional states, locations for the actions to take place, and goals to move towards. In an earlier episode, we called these more generic roles theta roles, and to guarantee that they get filled, we introduced the theta criterion, which is a kind of rule that makes sure that the scaffolding holding up our sentences contains just the right amount of space that each verb needs. Now, in a language like English, picking out which roles match which phrases is usually as easy as keeping track of a sentence's grammatical relations, like its subject and object. And since word order is pretty strict, it really just comes down to what shows up before the verb and what shows up after. As long as we're able to follow what goes where, we can sort of recreate who's doing what to whom. The subject's usually going to be the agent, while the object will typically be some kind of theme. But what about languages whose word order isn't as rigid? To tell apart subjects, objects, and other grammatical bits and pieces, languages with more flexible word orders make use of case. Case is a way of directly marking the grammatical role played by the parts of a sentence. The varieties of English spoken a millennium ago had a freer word order and used five different cases to keep on top of things. But over time, it lost these distinctions, and now only has a few. In modern English, case only shows up on pronouns. It's what gives us the difference between they, their, and them. On the other hand, modern German still has some flexibility baked into it, and keeps track of everything by altering the forms of its noun phrases. Both der Mann sieht den Hund and den Hund sieht der Mann can express the same thought, that the man sees the dog. The reordering doesn't mess with the basic idea, since German's nominative and accusative determiners point out the subject and object, respectively. Of course, we can't forget Latin, which on top of gender and number and five independent noun classes, infamously also employed six cases. Latin used various suffixes to express many of the categories we've seen already, while adding others like the vocative, which is used when addressing people. And case systems extend well beyond Indo-European languages, too. Hungarian puts Latin to shame with its 18 cases, and Japanese has at least 9. So it looks as if case is a handy way to follow the plot of a sentence without getting lost about which parts are doing what. It's like a costume or a uniform that words wear to tell the world, hey, I'm a subject, or look, I'm an object. But is that all there really is to the story, or can we throw on our spy glasses and look a little bit closer? As it turns out, we can actually gain a deeper understanding of what case is by asking another question we haven't fully explored yet, why words move. Going all the way back to the beginning of this series, we've been saying that words aren't always happy with where you put them. Sometimes they get a bit antsy and they need to go out for a walk. It's easiest to see this in questions, like in, what did Paige say to Pastor Tim? In theory, that what should follow the verb say, since it's what Paige said, and because English usually puts that kind of information after the verb, not before. But because it's a question, that WH word has moved over to the front. In this case, it's fairly straightforward to say that things were moved around to make it more obvious we're asking something instead of telling. But we've seen other kinds of movement that don't have as obvious an explanation. For instance, in our episode on raising verbs, we looked at sentences like, Paige seems to be worried about keeping their secret. We argue that the subject, Paige, is actually more closely connected to worry than seem, since people are generally worriers and not seemers. And so we concluded that page must be climbing out of the lower clause to become the subject of the higher one, since English sentences always need a subject, something has to fill that position. But that higher subject position can be filled in other ways, like with the non-referential pronoun it. So like, it seems that Paige is worried about keeping their secret, and in this case, Paige stays put. Notice that each option connects up to a slightly different structure. If Paige moves, the lower clause is tenseless, which you can tell because it's still to be. But if Paige stays put, it's tensed with is. We can't say either Paige seems that is worried about keeping their secret, or it seems Paige to be worried about keeping their secret. So what's going on here? Insight into how to solve this puzzle came in the early 1980s, when linguist Noam Chomsky proposed that this kind of movement actually revolved around the phenomenon of case. In particular, he suggested that case isn't only something that nouns may have, it's something that they must have, even if it isn't always so obvious, like in English. To be able to show up in any given sentence, a noun phrase has to go find a spot where it can receive case, and those spots are in limited supply. For subjects, it means being right up next to a tensed verb. Let's see how this actually works. So the idea is that we start off with a structure that has some verb in it, say pass. That verb needs an agent subject and a theme object to make up a complete sentence. In comes the theta criterion to make sure that those parts are filled. But this clause happens to be tenseless, which means that the subject can't stay put to get the nominative case that it needs. Luckily, there's a tensed verb in the next clause up, so the subject pronoun climbs to the top of the tree, where it can finally take the nominative form she. In tensed clauses, no movement is needed. We can be sure that nominative case must be assigned to noun phrases only in the presence of tensed verbs, because we never see it happen next to tenseless ones. In fact, in those cases where we do see subjects in tenseless clauses, because they have nowhere higher to climb, they've always taken on an accusative form, as in, they expect her to cooperate. It's as if, to rescue the subject of the lower clause from being filtered on account of its caselessness, the higher verb treats it as an object. Verbs like expect engage in this exceptional case marking because every noun phrase needs case to make it into the sentence. Even full noun phrases like meeting or investigation, which don't show any obvious sign of having case in English, need to either be direct objects or the subjects of tensed clauses. Extending the idea a bit further, we can even begin to see why different languages have different word orders. If it's true that all languages underlyingly have the same sentential architecture, the reason that noun phrases can show up in such drastically different places follows from each system assigning case in a different position. In English, an SVO language, nominative case is assigned to the left of the verb, but in VSO languages like Irish, it's assigned to the right. So, what ends up where really depends on where each language decides to hand out case. We've even seen what happens when noun phrases don't make it through this case filter. In the sentence, Gabriel claims to know what's best for the Jennings family, the subject Gabriel hasn't risen up out of the lower clause since he really is the one doing the claiming. But because he's also doing the knowing, we've argued that there must be a silent pronoun that refers back to Gabriel, sitting at the front of the embedded clause. So the sentence comes out to mean something like, Gabriel claims he knows what's best for the Jennings family. With this new idea at our disposal, we can finally make sense of why this should be. Because the lower clause has no tense, and the verb claim isn't the sort that can assign case to something following it, our silent pronoun is left out in the cold. As speakers, we understand it's there, but it remains unpronounced because it has no way of getting any case. If the theta criterion is like a casting director, this need for case, overt or otherwise, is kind of like an editor. A noun phrase might make it into a sentence, but if it can't manage to find the right wardrobe, it just won't make it into the picture. So we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week. If you move to the right place, you learn that case can be a good way of keeping track of which words are doing what in a sentence. That noun phrases actually need case, whether overt or covert, to actually make the final cut into our sentences. And that in order to get case, words sometimes need to move around, which explains certain kinds of movement and different word orders. The Ling space is made by all of these amazing people over here. If you want to learn more about how case works in passive sentences, check back on our website. And while you're there, why not check out our store? We're also on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling space, please subscribe. See you next time. Pinne kanam.